Good evening. Let's open tonight's service with hymn number 46 in the hardback hymnal, number 46. Let's all stand together. Our sorrow cease. 'Tis music in the sinner's ear. 'Tis life and health and peace. He breaks the power of canceled sin. He sets the prisoner free. His blood can make the foulest clean. His blood availed. Him ye deaf, his praise ye dumb, your loosened tongues employ. Ye blind, behold your Savior come, and leap ye lame for joy. Glory to God and praise and love be ever, ever kin. My saints below and saints above, church and earth and heaven. Please be seated.
Good evening. Let's open our Bibles together to 2 Timothy, 2 Timothy chapter 3. We'll begin reading at verse 14. But continue thou in the things which thou hast learned and hast been assured of, knowing of whom thou hast learned them, and that from a child thou hast known the holy scriptures, which are able to make thee wise unto salvation through faith, which is in Christ Jesus. I love the way the Lord phrased that. Faith, which is in Christ Jesus. All scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. I charge thee therefore before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall judge the quick and the dead at his appearing and his kingdom. Preach the word. Be instant, in season, out of season. Reprove, rebuke, exhort with all longsuffering and doctrine. For the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but after their own lust they shall heap to themselves teachers having itching ears, and they shall turn their ears away from the truth and shall be turned unto fables. But watch thou in all things, endure affliction, do the work of an evangelist, make full proof of thy ministry. For I am now ready to be offered, and the time of my departure is at hand. I have fought a good fight. I have finished my course. I have kept up faith. Henceforth, there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me at that day, and not to me only, but to all them also that love his appearing. Let's pray. Our gracious Father, we thank you. Thank you for your word. Thank you for the revelation that you've given us of yourself and of thy dear Son. Thank you for the Holy Spirit who opens the eyes of our understanding, gives us the faith of Christ and faith in Christ. Lord, we so need that work to be done for us tonight. We pray that you would send your Spirit in power, that you would cause your word to be effectual, that it would reveal the glory of Christ, and that it would put faith in our hearts, causing us to look to him and rest in him and rejoice in him. We ask it in his name. Amen.
Number 44 in the spiral hymn book. Number 44. Let's all stand together again.
Precious Savior, friend of sinners, we as such to thee draw near. Let thy Spirit dwell within us with that love that casts out fear. Matchless Savior, let us know thee as the Lord. Righteousness, cause our hearts to cleave unto thee. Come and with thy presence bless. Open now thy precious treasure. Let thy word here freely flow. Give to us a gracious measure. Is thyself we long to know. Come and claim us as thy portion. Let us all find rest in thee. Leave us not to empty notions. We would find our hope in thee.
Please be seated.
Let's open our Bibles together to 1 Peter chapter 5. For several months now, we've been trying to go verse by verse through this wonderful epistle that Peter is writing to those Jews that have been forced out of their homes. They've been forced out of Israel. They've been scattered through the four corners of the world, and Peter's writing to encourage them. And we find ourselves here in chapter 5, where the first four verses of this chapter, Peter is addressing the elders of those churches that he's writing to. And these verses are very encouraging and humbling to me as an elder, but I would remind you that we just read from 2 Timothy chapter 4 that all scripture is given by inspiration of God, and all scripture is profitable doctrine and for reproof and for correction and instruction in righteousness. And so though the elders in particular are being addressed in these first four verses, I trust the Lord will make these verses profitable to all of us. Verse 1 of chapter 5, the elders, which are among you, I exhort, I encourage, I come along beside and identify with. We looked at that word Sunday. And he says, who am also an elder. I myself was an elder and a witness of the suffering of Christ, and also are a partaker of the glory that shall be revealed. Let's just look at that verse before we go any further. A witness of the sufferings of Christ, and also a partaker of the glory that shall be revealed. If we hope to partake in the glory that has yet to be revealed, we must first be witnesses of the sufferings of Christ. If we are to participate in the glory of Christ, we must first be witnesses of the sufferings of Christ. If you turn your Bibles just a page or so over to 2 Peter chapter 1 at verse 16, Peter says, for we have not followed cunningly devised fables when we made known unto you the power and coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, but were eyewitnesses of his majesty. So now Peter is rehashing or recounting that experience that he had with James and John on the Mount of Transfiguration, when the veil of our Lord's humanity was temporarily taken away and the radiance of his glory shined forth, and Peter, James, and John were forced to the ground to hide their faces. And they heard the voice of God. Audibly, they heard the voice of God. This is my beloved Son in whom I'm well pleased. Hear ye him. And so Peter is now saying, we didn't come up with fables and stories that we made up. He goes on to say, look at the next verse. For he received from God the Father honor and glory when there came such a voice to him from the excellent glory. This is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased. And this voice which came from heaven we heard when we were with him in the Holy Mount. We handled the word of God. We heard the voice of God. We saw the radiance of the glory of God shining forth from the face of the Lord Jesus Christ himself. We're giving you firsthand testimony of what we witnessed. And so now he says in our text, in order to have any hope of partaking in the glory of God that shall be revealed, we must first be witnesses of the sufferings of Christ. And so Peter is giving testimony of when he witnessed and what he witnessed. Go back with me to 2 Peter chapter 1. You might think, well, Peter, James, and John, they had an experience. Boy, I wish I could have an experience like that. That would have been an amazing thing. I mean, sometimes we think, I'm sure that the apostles, having walked with the Lord and eat with him and hear him and see his miracles, had some advantage over what we experience. But I want you to notice the next verse. in 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 19. We have also a more sure word of prophecy, whereunto you do well that you take heed, as unto a light that shineth in a dark place until the day dawn and the day star rise in your hearts. We have Peter saying, as amazing as that experience was, we have a more sure testimony. We have a more sure witness than our personal experience in seeing the Lord and walking with Him and hearing Him. What is that more sure word of prophecy? Well, the next verse, verse 20. Knowing this first, that no prophecy of the Scripture is of any private interpretation, for the prophecy came not in old time by the will of man, but holy men of God spake as they were moved by the Holy Ghost. He's talking about the Scriptures, isn't he? He's talking about the revelation that God has made of Himself in His Word. In His Word. In the Scriptures. And I'm sure this is what our Lord meant when He said to those disciples, when they didn't want Him to depart, He said, "It is expedient for you that I go away. It's necessary. It's going to be better. It's going to be better for you with my departure. For unless I depart, the Comforter will not come. But when the Comforter comes, He's going to take those things which are of mine and give them to you. He's going to teach you. And you're not going to be dependent upon my physical presence or my audible voice. You're going to have the presence of God with you by the Spirit of God and by the Word of God continually." And I'm sure that's what the Lord meant when He said to Mary, when Mary grabbed, can you just imagine? Mary sees the Lord. She finally realizes this is the Lord when He says, "Rabboni." And He says to her, "Mary," and she says, "Rabboni," and she grabs for Him. What is she doing? "I lost you once. I'm not going to leave your side. I'm right here." What did the Lord say? "Mary, don't touch me. I've not yet ascended unto my Father." And if you look at that word "touch," it means don't cling to me. I don't think the Lord was saying to Mary, "If you touch me, you're going to defile me and I won't be acceptable to my Father." That's not what the Lord's saying. He's saying the same thing He said to the disciples. Don't cling to my physical presence. Don't cling to that which you can see and hear and touch with your physical senses. There's something better. There's a revelation. There's a witness. There's a testimony that's better than what you're able to experience with your physical senses. And that's the work of the Spirit of God, taking the Word of God and giving you a firsthand witness of the sufferings of Christ. Now here's what Peter's saying. Go back with me to our text. He's exhorting the elders, and he's identifying himself as an elder, and he's saying that I am a witness of the sufferings of Christ and also a partaker of the glory that shall be revealed. You know, when Thomas was not there with the other disciples the first time the Lord appeared to them, and then when Thomas came in and they began to all tell him what they experienced, what did Thomas say? "Oh, unless I can thrust my hand into his side and put my finger in the prints of the nails in his hands, I will not believe." And it wasn't long after that the Lord appeared. Thomas was there. And as soon as Thomas saw the Lord, he fell at the Lord's feet and he said, "Oh, my Lord and my God." And the Lord said to Thomas, Thomas, because you have seen me, you believed. But blessed are those who have not seen me, yet do believe. Blessed of God, with the grace of God and the spirit of revelation and truth to the heart through the scriptures. Blessed are you who have not seen physically with your eyes, audibly with your ear, but you believe. Why do you believe? Because you've been taught of God. You have an unction. You have the Spirit of God that has taken the Word of God and made you to be a witness of the sufferings of Christ. And the hope of partaking in His future glory is preceded by being a witness of His suffering. So those disciples that were literally there, physically there, they don't have anything on us. They really don't. Because the Lord said to them, you've got something better coming than what you've already experienced. And that's going to be the Spirit of God. It's going to teach you and reveal to you. I mean, just look what the disciples between the crucifixion and the ascension, they still had so much that they didn't know. Because on the Mount of Olives, when the Lord ascended into heaven, they asked, you know, the Lord had been teaching them for those 40 days between the crucifixion and His ascension, and had been appearing to them, and they still didn't know. Is it time now to establish your kingdom? It wasn't until after Pentecost when the Spirit of God came. The promised comforter, the one the Lord said that He would give to all of His children. For if you have not the Spirit of God, you're none of His. But if you have the Spirit of God and the Word of God, you have a testimony, you have a witness, you have an assurance of the sufferings of Christ. And that witness of His sufferings is what gives you confidence of partaking of His future glory. You see, we have to be, when John summarizes his gospel account in chapter 20, he says, many other signs did Jesus that are not recorded in this book. But these have been written that you might believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, and that by believing you might have life through His name. So this matter of faith, you know, you see people in religion now, you see, we're so prone to mind the things of the flesh and to look for an experience and to look for something that we can see and touch and feel. And what's the Lord saying? The witness that you have is spiritual. It's a work of grace in the heart where God teaches you by His word that these scriptures came not by private interpretation. Holy men of God wrote, this is a more sure prophecy than that mountaintop experience that I had. Peter speaking now. That mountaintop experience that I had when I saw the radiant glory of the Son of God shining forth. I have a better testimony now than I did then. You know, when God teaches you by His word and by His spirit, there's just no unlearning that, is there? Nobody can teach you out of it. You know it's true. To the core of your soul, you know it's true. you literally can't not believe. And that's not just a double negative. You can't not believe. It's impossible. When the Lord gives faith, the gifts of God are without repentance. In other words, when he gives the gift of faith, he doesn't take it back. He gives it. And faith comes by hearing, and hearing comes by the word of God. And so we have a God who does a work of grace in our hearts by his Spirit. Turn with me to Romans chapter 5. Feed my sheep is the title of this message. Feed my sheep. And God's sheep are interested, infinitely, eternally interested, completely, wholly interested in partaking of the glory that shall be revealed. And they want to know what is the prerequisite of partaking of the glory that shall be revealed. And Peter answers that question in our text. It's being a witness to the sufferings of Christ. That's the prerequisite. Being a witness to the sufferings of Christ. And he's not talking about physically being there 2,000 years ago on Mount Calvary and hearing audibly his voice. He's talking about having the Spirit of God take the Word of God and apply it so effectually to our hearts that we have a testimony, we have a witness. You know, that word witness is the same word from which we get our word martyr. Martyr. Believers have died, have been murdered, they've been burned at the stake, they've been fed to lions over their inability to recant the truth that God taught them. And I'm thankful that we live in a time where we don't have to worry about that. But if it changed, I'm also very confident that believers that have been taught of God will be witnesses to the end. That word martyr will be their experience, and God will give them the grace. They will not be able to recant what the Lord has taught them. they can't. They just can't do it. They are firsthand witnesses. I'm a firsthand witness of the sufferings of Christ. It's not hearsay. Not something I learned from somebody else. It's something God taught me. And that's true of every believer, isn't it? You have your Bibles open to Romans chapter 5. Look what our Lord says. Therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom also we have access by faith into this grace wherein we stand and rejoice in hope of the glory of God. We rejoice in hope of seeing his glory. Scripture says Christ in us now is our hope of glory. But we look through a glass darkly now, don't we? We only know in part now. He's revealed enough of himself. We've tasted enough of the heavenly gift to be desirous of sitting at that wedding feast and eating a full portion. We get our daily bread now, little crumb here, little crumb there, little pieces of glory and grace given to us now. And in that day, we'll see him in the fullness of his glory. And that's what he's saying here. by whom also we have access by faith into this grace wherein we stand and rejoice in hope. Hope that is seen is not hope. If a man sees it, why should he hope for it? Hope is something that we don't have yet, but we believe. In verse 3, and not only so, but we glory in tribulation also, knowing that tribulation worketh patience, and patience experience, and experience hope. And hope maketh not ashamed, because the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost, which is given unto us. Oh, here's where this hope comes from. The Holy Ghost sheds abroad the love of God in our hearts in Christ. And we taste of that love. And we see a glimpse of it. And we desire more of it. Paul said in Philippians chapter 1, verse 6, he said, being confident of this very thing, that he which began a good work in you will perform it until the day of Jesus Christ. The day of Jesus Christ is the full revelation of his glory. Seeing him as he is and being made like him. What is my hope of participating in that future glory? It is being a witness, a martyr, if you will, to the testimony of his suffering. Of what he suffered and why he suffered it. Turn with me to 1 John chapter 5. 1 John chapter 5. Right at the very end of 1 John chapter 5. Verse 20, and we know that the Son of God is come. We know that. We know he's come. We know that he left his rightful place in glory. We know that he was born of a woman, born under the law to redeem them that are cursed by the law. We know that he is Emmanuel, God with us. We know that he walked in perfect obedience to his Father for 30 years, and then he began his public ministry, being baptized and declaring himself to be the Christ. We know that he went to Calvary's cross, and he bore in his body the sins of his people. And he put them away once and for all by the sacrifice of himself. We know that. We know that God saw the travail of his soul. We know that God said, I'm satisfied. We know that the work required for the redemption of our sins is finished. We know that. The Son of God has come. He's come and he's accomplished what he came to do. He actually saved his people. And he has given us an understanding. Where did we get this from? We got it from him. What do you have that you did not receive? Father, I thank thee that thou hast hid these things from the wise and the prudent, and you've revealed them unto babes. Empty vessels. You remember that story in 2 Kings of the widow woman who lost her husband? And Elijah the prophet said, go borrow empty vessels, as many as you can, make it not a few. And she brought in, her son brought in all these empty vessels, and she began to pour oil in them. And the oil flowed as long as there were empty vessels. And as soon as the last vessel was filled, the scripture says, and the oil stayed, it ceased to flow. The oil of the Spirit of God only flows into empty vessels. Those who are able by the grace of God to come into his presence, completely dependent upon his grace, completely dependent upon his mercy. Lord, I'm dependent upon you. And we know that the Son of God is come, and he has given to us an understanding that we may know him that is true. Paul said, I know whom I have believed, and I am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I've committed unto him against that day. And this is life eternal, that they might know thee, the only true God, and Jesus Christ whom thou hast sent. How do we know him? Well, the Lord told the Pharisees, search the scriptures, for you think in them you have eternal life, but these are they which testify of me. In the volume of the book it is written of me. And so the Lord, by his Spirit, is pleased. It goes right back to what Peter said. We have a more sure word of prophecy than that mountaintop experience. We have the word of God, which is profitable. It's profitable for doctrine and for reproof, for correction. What did Peter, what did Paul say to Timothy? Remember the scriptures which are able to lead, to save your soul. They're able to lead you. I forgot how Paul said that in 2 Timothy chapter 3, but these scriptures are unto salvation. They are unto salvation. And we, verse 20, and we are in him that is true, even in his Son, Jesus Christ. This is the true God. This is eternal life. We have life in Christ. In Christ. He is our life. He doesn't just show us the way to life. I am the way, I am the truth, and I am the life. No man can come to the Father but by me. Oh, what hope we have, brethren. Turn back with me to our text. What hope we have. What is required to be a partaker of the glory and the hope that has yet to be revealed. That's what we want. That's what we're longing for. That's what we're living for. We're living to die. We're living to leave this body and to be with him. And what is required for that? To be a witness of the suffering of Christ. That when he bowed his mighty head and cried, it is finished, Father, into thy hands I commend my spirit. His suffering met all the requirements that God had in his justice and in his righteousness to put away our sin. And we're sure of that. We're sure of it. We're believing something. We're more sure, believers are more sure of what the Lord Jesus Christ accomplished 2,000 years ago than they are of what they experience in this world, in their bodies. That's what Peter was saying in that text, and that's our experience too, isn't it? You know, our experiences in this world are subjective. God teaches you there's no subjectivity to it. It's just true. And he teaches you about Christ, puts you in Christ, gives you love for Christ, and the desire to know him. This glory that shall be revealed in us, where there's no more sin, no more sorrow, no more suffering, no more sickness. No more sadness, no more death, no more darkness, no more crying, no more conflict, no more fear, no more war. Wars and rumors of wars, the Lord said they'll always be here, and they are, aren't they? Always been here in my life. According to the word of God, they're not going to go away. It's a world peace is a pipe dream. It ain't going to happen. God's already made that clear. I mean, we pray for peace. We work for peace. We Pray for our national leaders that they'll have, but we know that if this conflict gets settled, there's going to be another one. Going to be another one. No more sea. No more turbulence, no more separation, no more trouble. That's what the believer is longing for. That's what he's living for. To see Christ in the fullness of his glory and be made like him. We were talking about Bert before the service today, and somebody said, well, you know, we're so thankful that he's not suffering anymore because he suffered a lot, you know, before he died. And I thought, well, I am too, but, you know, what Bert is experiencing right now is not just the lack of suffering. I mean, it's a whole lot better than the lack of suffering. He's experienced something we don't know anything about in our experience. We're just hoping for it. We're looking for it. We're longing toward it. And we're trusting that God is faithful to his word. This is the duty of the elder. That's what Peter's saying. Go back with me to our text. The duty of the elder is to flee, to feed the flock of God. The elders which are among you I exhort, who am also an elder and a witness of the sufferings of Christ, and also a partaker of the glory that shall be revealed. Are you a witness of the sufferings of Christ? If you are, then you have good reason to hope in the partaking of his future glory. Because that's the prerequisite for partaking in his future glory, is being a witness of his suffering. Feed the flock of God which is among you. I'm so thankful. Yeah, you know, I have pastor friends, and we talk and we pray together, and you know, we pray for each other, and we sometimes, you know, bear one another's burdens. But I'm so thankful that I don't have the responsibility of another congregation. This is feed the flock which is among you. I've known men that get involved in other preachers' responsibilities. And they, you know, they try to fix everything out there. You know, just stay home and fix your own problems. You got enough. You got enough on your own plate to just stay right there. I don't have any interest in trying to get involved in somebody else's problems. And there are problems in every church. And I'm thankful the Lord is saying to me right here, you just feed the flock that's among you. Be responsible for them. That's all you can handle. That ought to be the pastor's life, isn't it? Ought to be a preacher's life, just to invest his whole life in the flock that's among him. Not worried about traveling around and making a name for himself and fixing other situations. Just put your nose to the grindstone and stay right there with your own flock and with your own people. Love them, teach them, care for them, pray for them. Taking the oversight thereof. By the way, the word pastor is the word from which we get our word Episcopal. I'm sorry, Presbyterian. And it means, let me get this straight. The word pastor is translated shepherd. And it has to do with feeding the sheep. The word pastor is the word shepherd. It has to do with feeding and protecting the sheep. And that's what Peter's talking about here. Two other words that are used in Scripture is elder, which he already used in verse 1. And that is the word from which we get our word Presbyterian. And it means elder, one with wisdom. And then the third word that's used in the Bible to describe this office in the church is the word bishop. And that's the word from which we get our word episcopal, and it means to be an overseer. They are all three used interchangeably to define the same office in the church. And religious organizations that create a hierarchy of leaders, bishops and elders and pastors and those sort of things, they've misunderstood what the scriptures are teaching here. These are just three different words used to describe the same office: elder, pastor, and bishop. And they're different functions of the pastor's responsibility for the flock that is among him. He's to oversee, he's to provide wisdom, and he's to feed and protect the sheep. Okay? So, feed the flock of God which is among you, taking the oversight thereof, not by constraint, not forced, unwillingly, but willingly. James says if a man desire the office of a bishop, he desires a good work. And so if the Lord puts it on a man's heart to pastor, as difficult as that is, and as difficult as it is for him, particularly, the Lord gives him a desire for it. And so he's saying, don't do it by constraint, do it willingly. And not for filthy lucre. Now, we often think of filthy lucre as being money. And certainly there are a lot of men that use religion to benefit themselves financially. But filthy lucre here means profit. Or it means reward. It means gain. And I'm certain that there are plenty of men who have taken on the office of an elder or bishop or pastor who have in the back of their mind or in the dark recesses of their hearts that somehow their ministry is going to give them an advantage with God and earn them some righteousness. And that's what the Lord's saying here. Don't do it for that. Because it's not going to give you any gain as far as your righteousness is concerned. It don't matter how committed you are or how sacrificial you are or what you do or how good you are at it. There are men who believe that gain is godliness. Gain is godliness. That if they have a large following, that's the evidence of God's blessings upon them. And it's some sort of establishment of merit with God. Godliness with contentment is great gain. And here's godliness, Christ manifested in the flesh. That's our godliness. Christ is our godliness. And our contentment is with him. It's just with him. And so he's saying here, you know, don't do it for filthy lucre. Do it with a ready mind. What is a ready mind? A ready mind is a mind that is giving itself to the immediate circumstances, not worried about the results. So we can't preach, we can't minister, we can't do anything thinking about what sort of result is this going to be. It is required of a steward that he be found faithful. Lord, I'm just going to faithfully do what you've called me to do as best of my ability and by your grace, and then trust you for the results. That's a ready mind. Whereas filthy lucre is doing it with an eye toward some benefit, some profit, some gain. Neither, as being lords over God's heritage, but being examples to the flock. Not overbearing, demanding respect, requiring people to submit to your authority, cracking the elder's whip and making sure that men are disciplined properly. No.
That's what the Lord said. Don't do it like that. Do it out of love. And do it humbly. And do it as an example. What is it that you want others to be? You be that. You be that. If you are overbearing and demanding and overruling, that's what you're going to get.
In verse 4, and when the chief shepherd shall appear, you shall receive a crown of glory that fadeth not away. And that's what Paul was saying. There is reserved for me a crown, and not for me only, not for me only, but for all those that are waiting for his coming, looking in faith to the glory that shall be revealed. All right. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, thank you for your word. Lord, by your Spirit, we ask that you'd make it profitable to our hearts, to our church. Grow us together in your grace and the knowledge of Christ. We ask it in Christ's name. Amen.
296.
Let's stand together.
My song through endless ages, Jesus led me on.